shall I begin? Or something?
Sure.
Okay.
That sounds good.
I know some people are asking about the art on my wall because it's changed. Really, everyone wants to know. And we started a festival at Curtis where I'm on Zoom all the time now. So we had an emergency triage session on the wall to make it a little more nice and to maybe take a little of the emphasis off of the guillotine there, the paper cutter. So there we are. Hi, I'm David Ludwig, and this is the second lecture that I'm giving for the Atheneum and for Curtis. Every year for, I guess, a dozen years, Curtis has been coming through Curtis on tour to Nantucket every summer. And that's been really made possible by Mark and Robin Rubenstein. And we love it. It's such a highlight of our year. So as you can imagine, if you're on island, you can imagine how disappointed we are not to be able to be there with you. But this is life. And we're happy to make any connection and very grateful to the Atheneum for hosting these talks because the Atheneum has been a great partner really ever since we started. And it's a wonderful place to play concerts and has a terrific audience. So thank you to Janet and Amy as well. If you have any questions about this, we're doing the brief history of Western music in 60 minutes. If you have any questions at all, you can put them, if you're on Zoom watching this, you can put them in the Q&A section. We'll pick it up if it's in chat, but Q&A is good. And if you're on YouTube, apparently, my handlers will convey to me whatever questions you might have. So I'm going to share the screen now and we're going to get started. All right. A brief history of Western music in 60 minutes. And Andy and Brett, I know that you are watching. If anything happens, if I don't know, if anything technical happens or stops working, you'll let me know on our chat. So music, the history of music, Western music, is one that goes back as long as we've had notated music, as long as people have written music down, we have record of it and can analyze it and get a sense of it and understand it better. When we say Western music, we're talking about composed notated music. Of course, there's all kinds of Western music, including country Western music, but we're not talking about that today. Instead, we're talking about really the literature of music, the canon of music that goes back 1,000 years. And that's an exclusive rather than inclusive canon. And if you spend any time on Twitter and follow musicians, you'll see that there's a lot of conversation and contention about even the idea of having a canon. As I said, it's not an inclusive one. In other words, as we go through the history of music, and certainly really until the 20th century, we're not gonna see everyone kind of, there's something they have in common, males and European. And that's where the tradition comes from. So there's a couple of reasons for that exclusion. One is geographical. I wonder, for instance, how many non-Europeans Bach met in his entire life. Probably not many. So you have a very small cohort of people who would even be a part of this tradition, geographically speaking. But also, it's what we do know very well is that women, for instance, were not really permitted to study music. They were permitted to study music, but not composition specifically. So for women and some incredibly accomplished musicians and instrumentalists are in our history, but with composers who are kind of creating work for posterity, it was an art form that women were not really not permitted to pursue, and it just wouldn't happen. And that's an unspeakable loss, because if we think about Mozart, Mozart had a sister named Maria. She lived twice as long as he did. She was apparently just as gifted. You can only imagine what would happen to our repertoire with another Mozart who lived twice as long. But she was never permitted to study composition, even though she composed. And the other, of course, is just the erasure of history, that history favors the privileged. And so it's a question, you know, is it that people were not given the opportunity to compose? Or is it that the people who are excluded were given some opportunity, but have been erased by history? And I would guess it's somewhere in between, a combination of things. I want to start with that preamble because it's important. And it's something that I didn't get much of in my music history studies when I was a student. But I think it's a very positive thing that we're seeing progress in the world as people are starting to ask these questions. The system of notation that we have for music is one of the great accomplishments of humankind. And it's a system that developed and has developed and continues to develop today. And it's a hybrid system. So it's a system that incorporates words. So you get the title of the piece, the name of the composer. It includes numbers. So we have a tempo. If you see there, quarter note equals C, which is short for circa, so around 44. That's 44 beats a minute. If you think 60 beats a minute is 1 second per beat. So this is 44. So that's each beat is a little longer than a second. So it incorporates words, it incorporates numbers, it incorporates symbols. We call these dynamics, piano, mezzo forte, et cetera, to show how loud. Piano means soft, mezzo forte means kind of loud. Maybe mezzo forte means meh. I should tell that to my students, meh forte. I like that, I'm gonna use it. But so these are symbols really, even though they are representing something. And then pitches, these are, it uses an alphabet. So words, numbers, symbols, and alphabet. We refer to pitches by their letter name, at least in the United States and some other countries. So G, C, G, A flat, E flat. These are, you don't have to read music to understand that we refer to pitches by letter names. So that's the hybrid. It all comes together to make an exquisitely specific way of identifying what a performer should do. It is highly, highly scripted. So there's actually very little in the ways of improvisation when it comes to much of this music. These are eras that could apply just as well to art history or literature. And they really, in music, come into three basic shapes, three larger formats. Early and ancient music, common practice in the modern age. And if we were to think about analog in art, we would think about artwork before the ability to create realism and perspective, then the period of realism, which coincides pretty well with this, and then the 20th century, the modern age. Early composers. This is the first ever piece of notated music. It's a cuneiform tablet from the city of Ugarit. And this is a hymn. People have recreated it. You can go onto YouTube and hear it. Pretty cool. The ancient Egyptians had a notation. It's called a hieronomy, which, I don't know if you had this, but when I was a kid in Mrs. Moyer's music class, she would go, hello, boys and girls, and do various, or if you can think about Close Encounters of the Third Kind, I think it was, they do this kind of thing. So it's a psalmification. It's using hand signals to show different pitches. That's the only singing I do. in this whole lecture. Maybe not, actually. In ancient Greece, there was a notation system based on an alphabet. And there are a few fragments left for different instruments and various hymns and some funereal epitaphs that could be sung. But all of these systems kind of died out. And in the so-called Dark Ages, around the time of the later Roman Empire until the early medieval, we really have almost nothing. That starts to change around 700 and 800 AD. And what's fascinating is this system kind of sprang up in different parts of Europe all at around the same time. We don't know if there's some progenitor because this system of neumes occurs in different places. And what are these things? So this is the modern version of these squigglies. Basically, it's this. Notated music starts in the church. The church was the center of literacy in Western civilization during the medieval times. And so monks together in monasteries would sing Gregorian chant. They would sing single line melodies all together. I'll play this for you in a second and you'll recognize this sound. And as the repertoire grew, as there were more and more chance to learn, very naturally, this is the thought, some monks would just kind of write down these little symbols to remember how the music went. And it served its purpose. This isn't like some primitive notation. This is actually, this did exactly what they needed to. They needed to remind them, do I go up or down here? Is it two notes? Is it three? And so this is the earliest notated Western music that we have, Gregorian chant. It arises in the church, in the Catholic Church. This is well before Protestantism. And it is descended from Hebrew chant. Assume that everyone could hear that. I can't see anyone, which is a little unnerving, but I assume Andy or Brett would have texted me if they couldn't hear, if they just saw me sitting in silence, staring in the distance. So yes, good. Thanks. This is what those neumes look in the wild. The word neum is probably from the Greek word for breath. And you can see a text, alleluia, this kind of thing. I told you I wouldn't sing again, and I did. But this is kind of what they look like in manuscript books. And we, some of us are familiar with the idea of the monks writing slowly these beautiful illuminated manuscript books. And this is how music was written down. Well, this evolved quite a bit into something much more specific. And those little squigglies turned into punctum or points. And each little figure became its own thing. And actually, if you went to the Vatican now and heard chant, they still use this system to notate in their chant books, which is really interesting. But it goes back to around 900 or 1000 AD. Here's an example of neumes 2.0, as we just saw, in a beautiful illuminated manuscript there. And this is a hymn to St. John, Sancte Johannes. And there's something very interesting here. Maybe you've heard of, you've heard of Do, Re, Mi, Fa, Sol, La, Si, Do, if not just from the sound of music. Do, a deer, a female deer. Re, a drop of golden sun. Mi, I'll stop. But ut became do over time. So this is actually an existing chant, and this is what gave a music theorist of the time named Guido of Arezzo supposedly invented this. So ut ke ana res ana mirade fa sol la. So this is where we call it solfege. This is where solfege comes from. And in probably more countries than not, this is how they identify pitches. So instead of saying C, they say Do. Instead of saying G, they say Sol. And it, you can sing then very quickly and easily with those, with that solfege. It flows. So you might have noticed with the Gregorian chant that everyone's singing the same line. It's a unison, we would say. And everyone's singing together. That finally changes around 1200 AD with some composers who were working in the Notre Dame Cathedral. And that includes a composer named Perrotin. He's one of the first composers that we have on record, a source who's known as Anonymous Four. I don't know Anonymous One through Three, but Anonymous Four wrote about Perrotin and his teacher Leonin. And Perrotin was the first to write polyphony. And polyphony is kind of what it sounds like, poly meaning many, phony meaning sounds. So instead of just having one line with everyone singing in unison, we have multiple lines. And the way that that manifests itself in this music is that one line holds a drone, holds a note, while two other voices sing over that in a kind of counterpoint. And the way that this music works, the words are viderunt omnes. So we're going to hear the first two syllables of this, V and then de. And you can hear how much the music changes, but he stretches like taffy the words. Oops.
V.
It's incredibly beautiful music. Not everyone knows this music, but whenever I play this for students, they kind of like, they're like, wow, you know, so much cooler than Philip Glass, even though Philip Glass is really cool, actually. Yes, this will guarantee that we don't use the recording. I know Philip Glass, and now I'm in trouble. All right. I just meant it's cooler than minimalism, but I didn't even mean that. I'm just going to keep digging a hole for myself. So troubadours. Troubadours were the first secular composers, the first outside of the church. And some of these were noble people and some not. And they were troubadours. They would wander around the south of France, going from court to court, singing songs. And, you know, part of the fact that they were not in the church meant that they had a kind of great freedom of expression and innovation. And they came up with many incredible innovations in notation and the way music was written. Again, we just have a single line for them, and we assume that they would go and sing and play with an accompaniment, but we don't even know that. And their songs were very like typical pop songs, like, I love the queen, but she doesn't love me. You know, who am I? I'm just some random troubadour, and she's married to the king, and he's rich and handsome. I could never get her, la, la, la. So unrequited love.
Mm-hmm.
Good. So you can hear, actually, there's a lot more flow in the voice. It's not quite so formalized. But really, most of the kind of progress, if we would call it that, and advances of music happened still in the church. This is, you know, fast forward another 160 years. So we're talking about big, big jumps in time we're doing here. This is a piece by one of the first internationally known composers.
Thank you.
Sure.
Named Guillaume de Machaut. And this is from a mass that he wrote. So the mass in church is, it's a service that happens on Sundays, as many of you know. And music accompanies that, and there's a standard format. This is considered the first multi-movement piece, the first multi-part piece, because each section, each part, each movement uses the same material, the same melody to hold it together. We're going to fast forward from that another 200 years. Whoops. To another mass and another Kyrie movement, the first movement. And this is by a composer named Palestrina. And Palestrina really, what we've been listening to is counterpoint, the beginnings of counterpoint, punctus contra punctus, note against note. And when a piece has satisfying or good counterpoint, you can hear any individual line whenever you listen to it. When a piece has bad counterpoint, it gets muddy, it gets confused. So we think about composers like Palestrina and Bach very much as composers with exquisite counterpoint so that various melodies are playing at the same time. This is something we don't really have in pop music. We usually in popular music, it's like the troubadour music. It's one line sung over some kind of chordal accompaniment, the strum of a guitar, for instance, or the chords of a piano. But part of what really distinguishes this music is that everyone has their own line, their own melody, and those melodies weave together to make the overall sound of the piece. It's said that Bach used to take Palestrina's music and hand copy it himself just to get the technique into his bones. So you'll hear just how much music moved in the 200 years between Machaut and Palestrina.
Thank you.
it continues from there. So what we've heard now is the development of polyphony, the development of composers to have the skill to write multiple lines, as we've talked about. The next big development in music happens with technology and instrument making. Very, very fine instruments are created. Some of this violin here, Stradivarius, is worth several million dollars. The metronome, we have a very precise piece of equipment that, if you think about it, composers before this, the metronome, which is from 1815, and it was made by a Swiss maker named Maetzel, who had all the Swiss clock-making technology behind him. Before this time, if you wanted to know how fast a piece was, you had to guess. A composer would write allegro fast or adagio slow, and on context, you would have to take a guess. Now composers could directly communicate exactly how fast they wanted their piece to be played. So this is an amazing kind of receiver technology. The development of the printing press gives us, this is the first page of printed, the from the first printed music, first volume of printed music from 1501. And just the ability to make instruments to bend wood and metal starts giving us more and more sophisticated sounds, and that accommodates the better and better players. Instrumentalists, when we talk about exclusion also, to keep in mind that being a musician was not a particularly distinguished profession. Even Mozart and Schubert were buried in mass graves. So, musicians were, I don't know, somewhere in between, maybe like squirrels and actors or something like that. So it's interesting to see. And yet we have a growing developing ability to write more and more virtuosic music because musicians get better and better at playing instruments. And so music, you might have noticed, everything's been vocal that we've heard to this point. We see the rise of instruments and music changes once again, so that instruments become even more important than the voice. This is the woman who just came in and brought me a glass of water. Pretty cool. Let's listen to this. This is from Bach's Chaconne. And this is an extraordinary moment of virtuosity in this piece. Not long before, after what we just heard. Etc. When I think about, I'm a guitarist, and when I think about some of the pop guitarists that I grew up listening to, Stevie Ray Vaughan, Eddie Van Halen, I guess they all have three parts of their names, Jimi Hendrix, Prince, all of them, none of them could quite do this. This is a very different level of virtuosity. And all are extraordinary musicians, but the demands of a classical musician, just as an aside, when Bella, this is my wife, and this is the most frequently viewed video that Curtis has. When she played this piece, she did two takes, each of which were 16 minutes and 14 seconds long. So that gives you an idea about the precision and the kind of internal rhythm that a really great top level classical musician can have. So this brings us now into the common practice era. This is analogous to realism, right? The the Rembrandts and the Davids and the, you know, the Vermeers, etc. This is the common practice era. And I would say probably 75% of the music that you will hear from an orchestra or a chamber music series is from this time period. So we're talking about 300 really golden years between Bach and Mahler. So Bach was born in 1685 and Mahler died around 1910. So those are some pretty good goalposts. This is also where we have the rise of orchestras, musicians coming together to play, and even the idea of professional musicians as musicians as a profession. So the symphony, what is a symphony? Well, it's in a way, it's like the novel in music, an elaborate music composition for full orchestra, typically in four movements. That was the kind of standard. A concerto, that's when you see a soloist and with an orchestra accompanying them, sometimes in opposition, sometimes together. But when you see a soloist on stage, that's a concerto, soloist and orchestra. Could be a piano concerto, with a pianist, a violin concerto, whatever, a bassoon concerto, something crazy like that. Opera. Operas become incredibly important into the 1600s and really into the 17th century. Dramatic work with voice, and it's important that it's staged, characters, costumes. Oratorio also is a large-scale dramatic work with voice, but typically not staged. And probably the most famous oratorio is Handel's Messiah. This is also when form becomes more and more important and codified in music. And so we have forms, sonata, binary, rounded binary, ternary, blah, blah, blah. Form is important, but it's not even something that a lot of musicians think about. If we probably asked 100 accomplished musicians what rounded binary is, maybe 20 of them would have some kind of answer. And yet it's something we talk about a lot, so it's good to understand. Here's some more modern troubadours, the Beatles. When we talk about form, we often use A's and B's to show sections, contrasting sections. So this form is a very standard pop music form, A, A, B, A, B, or in this case, verse, verse, chorus, verse, chorus. And a little more involved analysis is A, A, so verse, verse, chorus, and then a transition back to A, to the verse, and then back to ending with a chorus and a coda. A coda is a little bit of music, a little tag at the end, to kind of round out a piece. So let's hear this.
Close your eyes and I'll kiss you. Tomorrow I'll miss you. Remember, I'll always be true. And then while I'm away, I'll write home every day and I'll send all my loving to you. I'll pretend that I'm kissing the lips I am missing and hope that my dreams will come true. And then while I'm away, I'll write home every day and I'll send all my loving to you. All my loving I will send to you. Close your eyes and I'll kiss you. Tomorrow I'll miss you. Remember, I'll always be true. And then while I'm away, I'll write home every day and I'll send all my loving to you. All my loving I will send to you. Darling, I'll be true.
Oops. Come on. I slipped with the mouse and the whole thing. Loving, all my loving, I will send to you. There we go. Sorry about that. So that's a basic form. This is another very basic form. It's called sonata form, and you'll hear about it a lot. Sonata just means a piece for an instrument or piece for instruments. So you can have a violin sonata, which is typically violin and piano, or piano sonata, which is usually piano alone, clarinet sonata. Usually if it's a single line instrument, saying sonata means that there's piano involved as well. But sonata form describes the form of probably 90% of first movements of pieces written during this common practice era. And it works, you present an idea, that's called the exposition. So usually a couple of themes, then you develop those themes. You hear them in different ways and forwards and backwards, and you develop out the material of the music. And then a recapitulation, meaning you go back to the beginning, and then often a coda, which again is a kind of wrap up. And if you think about it, this is like how we learn how to write essays in high school, like a 5-paragraph essay form, that you begin with, here is my statement. The moons of Jupiter are many, and some of them are very interesting. Then you develop it. This moon does this, this moon has oceans, this moon is, you know, oblong, blah, blah, blah. Then recapitulation. And so the moons of Jupiter are very interesting. And then coda. And in closing, I hope that people get more into astronomy or whatever. But you see the idea. This is actually a very organic form and one that applies to many different kinds of things. And this is a fundamental form in music history. We see motives, melodies, and themes develop around that. So here's a well-known piece. We're going to hear the exposition of it, a couple of themes. And Mozart is going to take this and lead us into the development next. And you can listen to that piece. Most of us have heard it, Einklang Nachtmusik, a little night music. The idea of themes and melodies and motives are very important. This is the horizontal in music, the idea of a melody or a tune. This is what really makes music memorable. It's not even the notes themselves, it's the space between the notes. So we hear this in Beethoven's Fifth Symphony. That little bit is the kernel. It's the DNA that will unravel to become the entire piece. And so it's very interesting to hear what Beethoven does with this to make a unified piece. He actually uses that idea, that simple idea, that little germ to go in every single movement. So here's in the second movement, we hear ba 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 bum. That space is we always remember, but also there's something even more fundamental, short, 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 long, like a piece of Morse code. So we hear that in the second movement too. We hear it in the third movement, much more on the surface. This is much more obvious. Ba-ba-ba-bum. And then at the very end in the coda, the last part of the symphony. So da 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 dum. Instead of going ba 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 bum, he then reverses it ba 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 bum, but it's still the same thing. Beethoven knew that even unconsciously, taking that one germ and that piece of DNA and building an entire piece out of it will create a kind of unity in our minds, just like a great filmmaker will plant some object in a film and we see that keep appearing, or every time the color red appears, this happens. So music is the constant intersection of the horizontal and the vertical. The horizontal are things that happen over time, melodies, motives, themes, tunes. The vertical are chords, harmonies, things that happen in simultaneity at the same time. And so music is this constant meeting. This is the music right in the middle, this constant meeting of the horizontal and the vertical. And so harmony, agreement, blah, blah, blah. There was a barber I used to go to when I lived in Vienna named Harmony. I don't know why I said that. Anyway, music, a simultaneous combination of tones. That's a harmony. Notes happening at the same time, a chord. This composer, George Walker, is a Curtis graduate. He's a Pulitzer Prize winner. He was actually the first African-American composer to win the Pulitzer Prize. One of the most celebrated American composers in history. We're going to hear from a piece that he wrote actually right around the time he was a student in 1944. He just passed away last year. And we're going to hear some very beautiful examples of harmony, simultaneity, chords happening, and you're going to hear a very simple melody happening over those chords. Sorry, let me get there. That last moment, they all play together. That's a harmony, that's a chord. And so music is the constant intersection of harmony and melody. Not all pieces have harmony or melody. So I don't mean to pigeonhole music like that, but the vast, vast majority of pieces do. In the interest of time, I'm just gonna skip over Wagner. And that gives me a certain kind of pleasure because he was a big jerk. And so we get to the 20th century, the modern age, and you can see things start to change in terms of who is composing and who is given the opportunity to compose and be a creative artist. It's a century of ideas. So we have these movements that happen in music, just as we do in art and literature and dance and theater. Late German Romanticism of the 19th century, the Romantic composers, and Impressionism happens around the turn of the century as well, just as it does in art. It happens a little earlier in art already in the 1860s. The Impressionism in music, which has many similar concerns to art, starts around, really around the turn of the century, the fin de siècle. What was nationalism in the 19th century becomes indigenous modernism, music written using materials from a nationality, an ethnicity, a background, and pretty much always from the composer's personal background or area of interest. Not always, but almost always. Neoclassicism, which happens in France, where composers write in the style of older music, but through a new lens, so slightly altered, that eventually becomes really postmodernism. That's where we are now. Experimentalism, so early pieces that experimented with electronics, with sounds, that challenged the notion that every piece has to have harmony and melody, that becomes very influential to electronic music and then performance art. And then serialism, this is the beginning of abstraction in music that happens also around the turn of the century, very analogous to cubism. That leads to total serialism. So serialism is a way of planning out your notes so you no longer feel like there's a home base. Harmony gets completely turned on its head. And it's hard music for a lot of people to comprehend. However, it was a complete revolution in music. And for decades and decades, what defined you as a composer was whether or not you accepted serialism as your way of composing, as your technique, or rejected it. So serialism, as I said, is very connected to abstraction. Serialism wasn't the only kind of abstraction in music. Both of these paintings, by the way, happened really at the same time as abstraction in music. The Picasso over here is 1909. The Duchamp over here is 1912. This is one of the most important pieces of the early 20th century, maybe the most important, in a way like Beethoven 9, a piece that would inspire and influence every composer who came afterwards. This is Stravinsky's Rite of Spring. This was a ballet he wrote about, the subtitle is Scenes from Pagan Russia. So it's about ritualistic sacrifice and, you know, primal earth dances and so forth, what would happen in ancient Russia. And this piece caused such a stir when it was premiered that they say there was a riot. I think lowercase r, but still it was enough that Stravinsky had to be escorted out. People were booing, people were singing. No one knew what they were even hearing. And here's an example. What you're going to hear is something that sounds to me a lot like a mobile, right? Like Alexander Calder, or the idea of a mobile over a baby's crib, where you have many different moving objects all going at the same time. In a way, it's like musical traffic. When Stravinsky was writing the piece, he would have friends come over and he would try to play it on the piano. And he would say, I don't even know how to write this down. So this is a huge step toward abstraction, but also it's a reflection. Music, you know, art reflects culture, art reflects life. And so this is a reflection really of the modern era, of the idea of many, many layers of information all coming in at once. This is what we have in cubism as well. So no artist really defines the 20th century in terms of style as much as Picasso. So when we have cubism, again, this is from around 1911 on the left. This is later synthetic cubism, three musicians on the right. The idea of serialism, the idea of composing by creating a series of 12 notes and changing them and repositioning them. This is the second Viennese school. The first Viennese school would have been Mozart and Haydn and Beethoven. This is the second Viennese school. Nationalism. and indigenous modernism that is embraced by Picasso and Guernica in this famous painting about the Spanish Civil War. And we have these composers, Bartok, really the first ethnomusicologist obsessed with folk tunes from Eastern Europe, especially Villa-Lobos in Brazil, reflecting samba and influences of his time, Scott Joplin writing Rags, writing an opera, Tremonitia, which incorporated a lot of the folk and popular music of his time. Neoclassicism, this slide's out of order. This is in France, so serialism's happening in the German-speaking world. In France, we have neoclassicism, and actually Stravinsky's music changed quite a bit around 1920 and started sounding a lot more, the people who disparaged him said it sounded like Bach with wrong notes. Terrible, but Poulenc, Stravinsky, Prokofiev start writing a neoclassical music. And this is what that looks like in art, right? This is referential to ancient Greek sculpture, to traditional painting, even though it's clearly not a traditional painting. That's very much how the music presents. And then experimentalism, this wonderful Picasso sculpture, experimental music would include people like John Cage, Yoko Ono, Henry Cowell, Charles Ives. Charles Ives from Danbury from Connecticut, not far from where a lot of people listening are, one of the great insurance salesmen of all time, worth $30 million when he retired. I know. But also actually one of the most influential composers in the history of America. And so in our remaining 10 or 15 minutes, you didn't expect to have a quiz, and I can't see anyone, so I have no idea if you're going to be taking it, but you know, play along. I'm going to play for you five excerpts. And the question is, what decade of the 20th century do you think each piece was written? So here is number one. Okay, here's excerpt two. Here's excerpt three. Excerpt four. I'll just fast forward there. Okay, and excerpt five. Okay. So just to review, excerpt one. This is actually Stravinsky. As I mentioned, he became a neo-composer. This is like neo-Renaissance music. Excerpt two. Some of you might have guessed this was from the same period because you hear some big band music, and you'd be right. This is Leonard Bernstein, also a Curtis graduate, from his first musical, Fancy Free. So two pieces, very different, written at the same time. That is Pierre Boulez, a very early work. Maybe you can see where this is going. His second sonata he wrote when he was 23, highly influenced by serial music. This sounds like romantic music from Germany, and you'd be right about that too, except it's Strauss's last piece, his four last songs. This is a piano, believe it or not, written at the same time. John Cage's sonatas and interludes for prepared piano. So look at how much music fractured by the middle part of the 20th century. If we went back 100 years before that, we would see kind of Brahms or Schumann versus Liszt, but we wouldn't see nearly the diversity, the incredible breadth, the difference between Stravinsky and Boulez or Bernstein and Cage is extraordinary. And that's the fracturing that happened in all of the arts through the 20th century. This is because people are always wondering, how is that a piano? Well, this is John Cage. This is prepared piano. There he is preparing a piano, putting nuts and bolts in there. We're not allowed to do this at Curtis, or pretty much anywhere. It's not great for pianos, but Cage was playing for a dance troupe and wanted the dancers to get the rhythm better. So he discovered by placing these bits of hardware and screws and bolts and so forth that he could get these extraordinary sounds. Music has democratized now over the past 50 to 60 years with the advent of electronics, things like Guitar Hero, synthesizers. This is from my youth here. The automatone, this is a wonderful Japanese instrument. And the theremin, this goes back to 1919, the first electronic instrument. Electronics have really changed things, as have recording. If you think about Beethoven and all that time and effort he put into weaving that little kernel through his piece, and he did that with just about every piece he wrote. He had no expectation that people would hear his music more than once or twice, a piece like that, a big symphonic work, in their entire lives. With recording, that changes everything. And so we enter the period of now, postmodernism, where we become hyper aware of our roles in history, and very, very referential. Obsessed with celebrity, with popular culture, with trends, and thinking about ourselves in a historical context. So music of this time, much of it weaves together all these different movements, all the things that we saw in the early part of the 20th century to make new voices by the combination of disparate, very different influences. This is from 1400. This is an example of Augenmusik or eye music. Music that looks like what it sounds, or the subject. This is a love song written in the shape of a heart. This is a piece by George Crumb, an extraordinary composer who has an honorary doctorate from Curtis, someone I've gotten to know well. And he lives in Media, Pennsylvania. And this is Spiral Galaxy. This is a piano piece, but he shows the idea right there. And he's referring to this Renaissance practice. And so I'm going to close actually with an absolutely wonderful piece by a former student of mine who's gone off. She graduated a number of years ago, who is very successful now. She's living in France, still very young. And this piece exemplifies really where we're at and what people are writing now. It's called Carrot Revolution. You're going to hear popular music. You're going to hear minimalism. At one point, it turns into Baba O'Reilly by The Who. You're going to hear bluegrass. You're going to hear all kinds of counterpoint, and you're going to hear what's called extended techniques. So ways of producing sounds on instruments that are not the traditional way of making sounds. You'll also hear the influence of a lot of electronics and sounds that you just wouldn't expect from a string quartet. And yet it's still a string quartet. It's still in this long tradition, this 1,000-year tradition of notated music. You hear a little bit of everything in that piece. People love that piece, and composers today are really interested in communicating with audiences. Sometimes we think about contemporary art, contemporary music, and it can be very forbidding. And there is a lot of music written that requires either a lot of knowledge or a lot of, there's a big gate in front of it to get through. That is very cerebral. But I would say a majority of composers now are looking for a much more direct avenue of communication with audiences. And this piece is a great example of that. And so I put together a collage of my former students at Curtis. And you can see this has changed quite a bit. Composers are coming from all countries, from all backgrounds. And I think it's no coincidence that new music has had its own kind of renaissance. It is a powerful movement. Composers are composing today just like they did then, just as there are writers now, there were writers then, there are painters now, there were painters then. But that diversity has proven to be an extraordinary strength because the quality and kind of music that is coming out of these young people and hopefully their teachers as well is a new level of communicative and has an enormous impact. Composers are interested in social issues, in commenting on the world and in communicating and touching hearts. So That is the end of the lecture. If there are any questions, I'm happy to take them. Otherwise, we can say goodnight. Any questions at all are fine. Happy to answer anything. I see Mark is on the line here, Mark and Robin, and just always glad to have them. They do make our visits to Nantucket possible, and we're really missing them this summer, and the hot dogs. I mean, come on. All right. With that, thank you again for coming to this lecture. Thank you to the Atheneum and everyone who came to hear this. There will be more along the way, more other lectures I'm giving for other organizations, but it's been a great, great pleasure to collaborate and very hopeful to see you on island next year. Thanks.